Welcome, Eagles, to another episode of TradCatKnight Radio. I am Eric Juski, founder and owner of TradCatKnight, the most viewed and followed traditional Catholic apostolate worldwide. This is also home of the New Crusade. Now, today I have with me another special guest, Mr. Tony LaRosa. He is a part of the Catholic Resistance. He is a co-founder of Ecclesia Militans. It's a website. You can go to ecclesiamilitans.com, and he's putting out all the latest information there concerning what's going on in the resistance. A lot of great material there coming out of Canada, so make sure you're stopping by and supporting his apostolate. Support him financially, do whatever you do can do to help Tony in this mission to keep the principles intact that Archbishop Lefebvre left behind. And that's what today we're going to be talking about. I have Tony on in remembrance of Archbishop Lefebvre. Now, I know for myself, Archbishop Lefebvre was essential. He helped me put the pieces to the puzzle together when I knew there was something wrong in the church. And so I read several works of Archbishop Lefebvre, and it started to become all the more clear. And so he was a pivotal foundation, if you will. Others, such as Father Hess, Father Kramer as well. But so we remember Archbishop Lefebvre. So I'm going to hand it over to Tony, and perhaps he can give us a little bit more on his background, maybe the influence of Archbishop Lefebvre. And he wants to get going into talking about Archbishop Lefebvre a little bit more. So, Tony, welcome aboard.
Hi, Eric. Thanks for having me on. So basically, as many people, I started off born and raised in a Novus Ordo. And over the years, you know, I lost track of the faith, I lost track of the church. Then in my late 20s, I came back to the Novus Ordo, and I was really interested in learning about the faith. And I was in the Novus Ordo for about 6 years. And then I went to my first traditional Mass. And it was an indult Mass. And the very first thing that I observed was the reverence that was there with the altar servers and with the priest. And it got me very interested of learning of, you know, basically the past. What happened to the church.
Sure.
And from there, I was attending the indult for a bit of time, maybe a year, year and a half. And I got actually permission from my indult priest to attend the society masses during the week. So I was going there for basically first Friday, first Saturday, and then going to the indult, back to the indult on the Sunday. Well, that was bad advice for the priest to give me, because I actually started to like it.
Yeah.
I started to realize that, hey, you know, this is what the faith is about. In the indult, you know, right after the indult Mass, they would have the Novus Ordo. So slowly I moved away from that, and I told my priest I was permanently going to the Society of St. Pius X in Toronto. And he wasn't happy about that, but, you know, I think he understood overall. And so I started going to the Society full-time, exclusively back in 2005. And then from there, basically, I learned more and more about the Archbishop, about his life, about his writings. And really, a lot of the stuff he wrote to me just was really just common sense.
Yeah.
It really gave me truly an understanding of the crisis and, you know, where the church was before and what had happened to it. So ever since then, I've been basically, you know, a faithful follower of the Archbishop, and I basically consider him to be a saint. And
yeah,
you know, I have no doubt that one day he will be raised, he'll be canonized by the church. So today, in today's talk, what I would, I want to go through basically is break down my talk into three parts. The first part, I want to give a short history about the Archbishop, going through some of the major events in his life. And then the second part, I want to get more nitty-gritty into what he stood for and why he resisted. And then we'll end off with basically what I believe he would say about what's going on ever since his death, which was in 1991. So any questions so far?
No. You know, again, this particular piece, as Tony and I were talking off camera, is primarily for those who are not aware of the Archbishop. Again, we remember his death, March 25th, was in 1991, and he is sorely missed, to say the least, and having a profound effect, I think, for anyone who would label themselves a traditional Catholic, or in reality, we're just Catholics, but at least some effect. But I would say for the majority, he has had a profound effect, and I agree with you that he will be canonized one day. He is the modern day Saint Athanasius of our time. He, as I mentioned on my own radio show, was an eagle of his own day, and he saw things. At first it was a little wishy-washy, I admit, but then he was fluid throughout. And it's unfortunate what's going on in the USXPX, trying to paint him in a fashion which, it wasn't the Archbishop. How they're trying to paint him publicly, but it's very, very important for people to understand properly, what he stood for in principle, the fight against modernist Rome, because that's a big difference. As Tony mentioned, with the indulters, they're still essentially following the Second Vatican Council, and they're also not resisting the new mass. So if we have time, maybe I'll interject. We'll have a little segment called On the Question Of, and I've got six bullet points here if we have time, and we'll just talk about them. On the question of obedience, on the question of the conciliar church, on the question of state of accountism, either. If we can get into that, that'd be great, but I really want to let Tony roll with this. And so, Tony, you can take it back over.
Sure. So let's begin. Who was the Archbishop? Who was Archbishop Lefebvre? Well, Marcel Lefebvre was born on November the 29th, 1905, in northern France. His father ran a textile mill. And after high school, he joined his elder brother at the French seminary in Rome in October 1923. All his life, Archbishop Lefebvre had a great esteem for the rector of the French seminary, Father Henry de La Flocque, who taught him to love and revere the teaching of the popes. This priest would explain the great encyclicals written against modern errors such as liberalism, modernism, or communism. And on September 21st, 1929, Marcel Lefebvre was ordained to the priesthood by Cardinal Leonhard in Lille. He then came back to Rome to prepare his doctrine and theology while assuming the office of first master of ceremonies at the seminary. Now, having already earned his doctorate in philosophy, he obtained the doctrine in theology on July the 2nd, 1930. Now, Eric, I suspect that perhaps many people don't know this, but Archbishop Lefebvre was a doctor. You know, he had a doctorate in philosophy and a doctorate in canon law. He was a very learned man.
Yeah.
So it's important for people to understand that, because later on in his life, he would apply his knowledge to the situation in the church.
He was also, if I'm not mistaken, Tony, he was very keen into debating, having very, friendly debates amongst his colleagues, to always, keep fresh in mind just the art of debate, but to make sure that his followers and his peers knew and understood the faith very well.
For sure, for sure. So to continue with his life, from 1930 to 1931, he was assistant to a parish priest in a working-class suburb while awaiting the permission of his bishop to enter the Holy Ghost Fathers, which is a missionary congregation. And on September 1st, he began his novitiate, and he took his vows on September the 8th, 1932. On the 25th of June, 1947, he learned that he had been appointed an apostolic vicar of Dakar in Senegal, which is a country in Northwest Africa. And on Thursday, September the 18th, 1947, he was consecrated a bishop. In 1948, Pope Pius XII appointed him apostolic delegate, which is the equivalent of a nuncio, for French-speaking Africa. Now, this was a large area that he was covering. He was a pope's representative in one diocese, 26 vicariates, and 17 apostolic prefectures. And the total population in that area was about 2 million people. In 1962, he was then transferred from the See of Dakar to the See of Toul in France with the personal title of Archbishop. And in July 1962, Archbishop Lefebvre was elected the Superior General of the Holy Ghost Fathers by a comfortable majority. So, Eric, up until this time, we can see that the Archbishop was a man of the church. He was very well respected by the popes. Unfortunately, however, the tide would soon change.
Yeah.
On January the 25th, 1959, Pope John the 23rd announced the meeting of a council. Archbishop Lefebvre was appointed among the members of the Central Preparatory Commission of the Council. He attended all the meetings, which were even at times presided over by the Pope. And during these meetings, he witnessed clashes, sometimes they were violent, between the liberal tendency and the conservative members of the commission. During the council, confronted with the importance gained by the modernist theses, which received the support of a lobby, and this lobby, by the way, was very well prepared and organized, he founded the Cetus Internationalis Patrum with a few other bishops and was appointed its president. He then became acquainted with Bishop Antonio de Castromeyer, Bishop of Campos in Brazil, who had also become a member of the Cetus. By his actions in the Cetus and by his interventions at the conciliar sessions, he fought against the modernist influence spreading over the council. But alas, this did not prove sufficient. As superior general of the Holy Ghost Fathers, he fought against the falling of discipline and the theological deviations. Unfortunately, it was again without complete success, because the men he appointed to various offices were not always worthy of his confidence. He reformed the organization of his congregation, he transferred the motherhouse to Rome, traveled far and wide to visit his houses, and he organized and encouraged his religious. In 1965, began the aggiornamento of the religious congregations demanded by the Second Vatican Council. Archbishop Lefebvre meant it to be an opportunity for straightening out deviations and increasing the holiness of religious life. He was far from being against all the reforms, even the most daring, as long as they were faithful to the ideal of the founder. At the general chapter of his congregation in 1968, attempts were made to set him aside, and the prevailing majority was in favor of disastrous reforms. Now, for him to avoid signing decrees which would have brought his congregation in line with the reigning fashion of the day, Archbishop Lefebvre left the chapter after the election of his successor, and he withdrew to a small boarding house run by sisters in Rome. He was at that time 63 years old. For several years after that, priests and more especially seminarians were looking for a serious reformation, and he had directed some of them to the French seminary in Rome run by the Holy Ghost Fathers, which he had hoped he could keep doctrinally sound. But that was not the case. The rector of the seminary made little account of the advice of his superior. Others he later sent to a priestly society established in Rome, and others still to the Catholic University of Freiburg in Switzerland. As young priests and seminarians kept insisting that he undertake a work in favor of the priesthood, he decided to leave that decision to the Bishop of Freiburg, who readily authorized him to open a refuge for seminaries from all countries. So that at that time, the seminary was born. Archbishop Lefebvre rented 12 rooms at the Don Bosco House in Freiburg and welcomed his candidates on October 13, 1969. In June of 1970, he bought a house in Freiburg again to accommodate his seminarians that were to carry on their studies at the university. But at the same time, with the permission of Monsignor Adam, the Bishop of Sion, he accepted the house of Icon, which was offered to him by his owners, in order to open a year of spirituality for the newcomers. On November the 1st, 1970, Monsignor François Charrier, Bishop of Freiburg, approved the statutes written by Archbishop Lefebvre for the Society of St. Pius X, and he erected it in his diocese. The goal of this society, as expressed by the statutes, is the priesthood and all that pertains to it, and nothing but what concerns it. With the classes at the University of Freiburg being unsatisfactory, Archbishop Lefebvre obtained from the Bishop of Sion the permission to establish in Icona seminary, which would grow rapidly. Then a few years later, on November 11, 1974, an apostolic visitation took place in Icona, following some complaints from the French bishops against this seminary, which kept the mass and tradition and which was receiving vocations, while these other seminaries around the world were empty. So that got Rome pretty upset.
Yeah.
And then on November 21st, 1974, in a forceful declaration, he stated his adhesion to eternal Rome and his refusal of the Rome of neo-modernist and neo-Protestant tendencies, which manifested itself during Vatican II and after the council and all the reforms which issued from that council. We'll get into this declaration, Eric, a little bit later.
Sure.
Archbishop Lefebvre, after that, was called to Rome for an interview, which really was nothing less than a trial. On May the 6th, the society was illegitimately suppressed. This is in 1975. Archbishop Lefebvre appealed to the Supreme Apostolic Signatura, that's the highest ecclesia court in Rome. But Cardinal Jean Vallot, Secretary of State at that time, intervened to stop the canonical process. Well, calmly and peacefully, in the face of this denial of justice, the Archbishop decided to carry on with his work, considering that the society continued to exist, since its suppression was irregular, and in any case, it was unjust. In June 1976, disregarding the threats from Rome and judging that the fight he was leading was fundamental for the defense of the faith and of the Mass, Archbishop Lefebvre ordained 13 priests and 14 subdeacons without Rome's approval. For this, he was punished with a suspension ad divinis, which ought to deprive him of the exercise of any sacramental act. However, this sanction did not trouble him or catch him off guard. In a supernatural vision of his duty, he decided to keep up the good fight against all the deviations, which were already shaking the church. On August the 29th, he then proceeded to celebrate a public solemn high mass in Lille, France, before 7,000 faithful. The media made much ado about it and called him the rebellious bishop. Nevertheless, he was granted an audience by Pope Paul VI on September the 11th. There he discovered that he had been seriously culminated. However, the Pope did not want to make room for the mass of the St. Pius V because he was too anxious to impose his own Novus Ordo reform. While for the Archbishop, the sake of fidelity to the Church of all times, he did not want to accept the conciliar church nor the new mass. In September of 1976, he published his book, I Accuse the Council. And in this book, he speaks about his interventions at the council. In 1983, Archbishop Lefebvre, already progressively disappointed by the text of Pope John Paul II, tainted with modernism, was deeply scandalized by the new code of canon law, which codified into law the deviations of the council. He then seriously considered the consecration of bishops and engaged upon the path of public protest against the scandals perpetrated at the very summit of the church. In 1985, Archbishop Lefebvre submitted his dubia to Rome. These dubia were 39 propositions or doubts concerning the discrepancies between the conciliar doctrine of religious liberty and the previous teaching of the church. In October 1986, took place the awful scandal of Assisi under Pope John Paul II, which Archbishop Lefebvre answered in a joint letter with Bishop de Castromeyer. In March of 1987, he did receive an answer from Rome to his dubia. It was an unsatisfactory answer. In June 1987, the Archbishop published a book dealing with the destruction of the social kingship of Christ called They Have Uncrowned Him. In June 29th, 1987, Archbishop Lefebvre made public his intention to give himself successors in the episcopate. So we can see here, Eric, that for years the Archbishop, you know, he tried to deal with Rome. He tried to work with them, tried to make them see their errors,
sure,
but to no avail. So in 1987, he thought to himself, okay, I'm getting old now. I've got to start thinking about the future of the church.
Yeah.
And that's when he came to his mind to think about consecrating new bishops.
Yeah, and this is key to what we tried to speak about. I know Tony does too with his apostle, but if we can maybe speak just for a minute and tell everyone, Tony, why is it necessary for Catholics to resist at this point? You know, I've always been somewhat hard, so to speak, on the pseudo-traditionalist. But we have to remember, ladies and gentlemen, that the Catholic Church teaches, on the basis of teaching one heresy, you separate yourself from the body of Christ. And so we have in church precedents an example with the Arian crisis being laid down, where we can see very distinctly and definitively where the faith was not a Catholic. A Catholic could not be. They have the buildings, we have the faith. Now we have a situation where modernism has entered the church, the synthesis of all heresies. So we're dealing with heresy upon heresy upon heresy, which not only stems from the council, but it's extended, subsequently with the popes that we've had. So, I don't understand how some individuals can see what we're saying and still move along and try to pretend they're going along, so to speak, with the other fishes, and they're not really speaking publicly. But just in general, why is it necessary for us to resist?
Well, we have to understand, first and foremost, what it means to be a Catholic. Okay, people don't take it seriously enough. That's my observation.
Yeah.
People have to understand that the Catholic faith determines it. It determines your love for God. If you don't have the faith, you don't have love for God. And people will try to find other ways to love God, but God has defined for us how He wants to be loved, and He's made it clear that without the Catholic faith, you can't love Him, you can't know Him, and you can't love Him, and then you can't serve Him.
Right. That's in Scripture, right?
That's right.
Without faith, it's impossible to please God.
Correct. As I believe St. Paul said.
Yeah.
So if people took their faith more seriously and, detach themselves from the things of this world, they would come to understand the need to resist. And I think that's part of the reason why our apostolate, to some extent, has been successful, in the sense of we have a good group of people here who are resisting, and we support each other, and we keep in mind to each other that we can't compromise. We can't compromise on the Catholic faith. We've seen now since I've been in tradition, we've seen people come and go. And
sure.
I really believe that if people really understood and took the time to understand, read up on the faith, understand what the popes have taught, and then pray on it. Prayer obviously is critical. They will come to realize that we cannot do anything but resist in the face of attacks upon the faith.
Yeah, if I can add a point to that, I was on Twitter last night and I put out several messages just in relation to resistance in general. And I had one young man come on, and he had never even heard the word heresy before, and he was obviously Novus Ordo. And so for me, it's education. They're not even getting a Catholic education when they're going through the RCIA program, this or that, and they're not hitting some of the main essentials of our faith. And so I had to explain to this young man, heresy is, as a sin, is worse than rape and murder put together.
For sure. Yes.
And so, because it's mortal sin and it separates you from the body of Christ. And so that's why it has the appearance that we seem quote unquote schismatic, even though we're not. We're keeping free from the theological Ebola. And
that's right.
Yeah. Archbishop Lefebvre put it in similar terms. I think he called it AIDS maybe in one of his talks, theological AIDS. But that's what we have to do as Catholics. It's not that we don't want to be in the diocese, ladies and gentlemen. It's because modernism is there. The Catholic faith isn't right there. And so we have to pray for conversions. I didn't mean to interrupt you, Tony. You can continue.
Yeah, no problem. No. To follow up on that point, I agree with you 100%. What you see a lot of Catholics in the Novus Ordo, like you see them that they're very faithful to the natural law. Right, they'll fight against abortion, they'll fight against the perversion of homosexuality, and so on. But then they'll go and pray with Protestants and, picket an abortion clinic and pray some ecumenical prayers with Protestants. So yeah. I've had that happen in Toronto. But people have to understand, God's not going to bless that work.
Yeah,
we are here where we are now with our backs against the wall because of the fact that Catholics don't know their faith.
Yeah.
They don't know, that the first commandment comes first. So you can't go out and defend the fifth commandment, thou shalt not kill, And then at the same time, offend the first commandment by praying with Protestants, these ecumenical prayers. Yeah. So for sure, I agree with you. They are not these Catholics in the Novus Ordo, unfortunately, like as you said, they don't even know what the term heresy means. Well, if they listen to the Archbishop and they read his works, I think they, especially the Archbishop's book called Open Letter to Confused Catholics, I think they'll come to realize, you know, by the grace of God, and you know, and if they're a goodwill, you know, really what we've lost, you know, and where we are today. So,
yeah. And just before you pick up there, Tony, I know I want to pick up just some of the works that he has out there right now. 1998, a book came out, A Bishop Speaks, Writing and Addresses by the Angelus Press. 1998, as you mentioned, I Accused the Council, which is another popular one. The one that solidified it for me was Open Letter to Confused Catholics, came out in 1987. Then there was another one, 1997, Against the Heresies. 1988, they have Uncrowned Him from Liberalism to Apostasy, and a few others, and especially Religious Liberty. And that's a key aspect to the dethroning of the social kingship of Christ, which is it's nothing to sweep under the rug, which is what the new SSPX is trying to do. They're trying to make it not seem like it's a big deal when it is very much a heresy, and it very much offends Jesus because it uncrowns him. And that's what I talked about on the Caravan to Midnight show, for those of you who tuned in and listened, and helping to explain to some of these Protestants, you know, when you know, here in America, we quote unquote have this notion of religious liberty. Well, now you're putting Jesus Christ on equal footing in terms of a public right with Satanists and Buddhists. You know, how do you think that, you know, does or does that not offend Jesus? And of course that offends Jesus. So it's not something just to sweep under the rug and say, well, you know, I'm just going to kind of turn the other cheek and still go along with the other lemmings. You have to join in this fight. That's what we're fighting for, is the faith. Go ahead, Tony.
Yes. Yes, for sure. So going back to the Archbishop, at this point in 1987, he basically made public that he was planning to consecrate bishops. And then in the following year, February 2nd, 1988, he confirmed that he would consecrate at least three bishops for the good of the church and for the continuation of tradition, with or without the approval of the Pope. Negotiations began in Rome between the representative of the society and the members of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, at that time headed by Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger. This led to the signing of a protocol of agreement with Rome on May the 5th, 1988. However, the next day, realizing that Cardinal Ratzinger was not ready to grant him what he was asking for, the Archbishop recanted. He consulted with others, and then on June 2nd, 1988, he wrote to the Pope to tell him his decision to consecrate four bishops on June the 30th. And then on June 30th, he went ahead, he consecrated four bishops before 10,000 faithful and a crowd of journalists. During the ceremony, Archbishop Lefebvre explained the necessity in which he found himself to transmit the episcopacy for the good of the church and despite the opposition from the hierarchy. Well, an excommunication, which, you know, as traditionally we don't accept, was pronounced on the following day, July 1st. But it missed the mark. It did nothing more than underline the powerlessness of modernism, which had been formerly triumphant, but which was already decaying the church and filling it with its stench. During the 3 years after that, God granted him from 1982 to his death, the Archbishop gave his four young auxiliary bishops the support of his moral presence. He introduced his future heirs to the new office, leaving them the task of conferring ordinations, which he attended in all modesty. And then on March 25th, 1991, on the Feast of the Annunciation, which on that year fell on the Monday of Holy Week, at 3:25 in the morning, Archbishop Lefebvre gave back his soul to God. So, Eric, that's a little rundown of the history of the Archbishop. Do you have any questions before I proceed?
Well, yeah, like I said, we'll kind of interject some of these points in a little segment I have called, you know, On the Question Of. And, you know, to help individuals, whether they're Catholics or not, understand the question of obedience. It's a big topic, of course, when we're dealing with the topic of resistance, because, as you mentioned before, we now have to choose following God and the truth rather than following church men who have swayed from that truth and are literally teaching this Novus Ordo faith, which isn't our faith. It's a man-centered gospel It's not our gospel. It's certainly not the gospel of Jesus Christ, this impotent humanitarianism that Vatican II is preaching. And so on this question of obedience, you know, how would you respond to an individual who says, well, you're not following, you know, your local bishop, therefore you're outside the church?
Okay. In terms of obedience, we have to understand there's a hierarchy, okay? And that hierarchy starts with God, right? And God gives the authority to superiors, starting with the Pope, and then the bishops, and then the priests, and so on, to defend the faith, to teach the faith, to promote the faith, okay? That is their job, so to speak,
yeah.
Okay? And what if a Pope or a bishop doesn't do that, if he instead does things or teaches things that are against the faith, and he somehow pressures you or commands you to follow his way, well, basically, what's happening, if you do end up following him, then you are disobeying God. Because
yeah.
God is giving that person, that bishop or that pope or bishop or priest, the authority, once again, to promote the faith, to teach the faith, not to attack it.
Yeah.
So if you understand it from that order, it's like this. I'll give you a simple example. You know, you work for a company and you have a manager, right? Your direct department manager, for let's say, and your department manager says, do this activity this way, right? And then the president of the company comes down and says to you, no, you know what? Don't do it that way. Do it this other way. Who are you going to listen to? You're going to listen to the president of the company, right? Because why? Because that president has more authority than your direct manager, right? In the same way, who possibly can have more authority than God?
Sure.
No one. He is the source of all authority. And since all authority comes from him, you can't do something or follow the, you know, obey a command from an inferior, and, you know, anybody is infinitely inferior to God, even the greatest of the angels, even the Blessed Virgin Mary,
sure.
Right? So your duty at that point is to disobey, the lower superior, for the sake of the higher superior. And yes, unfortunately, you know, God's not going to come down and strike that pope or bishop right away and slap him in the hand that he's telling you to do something and, you know, you want a way out. You may have to suffer for it.
Yeah.
But think about who you're suffering for. You're
yeah.
suffering for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who suffered for you on the cross, right? And that the suffering that he asks of you, if he does, in that particular case, would be nothing compared to what he suffered for you. So we have to understand that hierarchy, put it in proper perspective, don't act on emotion, and let the cards fall where they may.
Yeah.
Where they may.
Yeah, to further that particular point, we have to remember St. John Chrysostom and the Church Fathers teach, is it tradition? Go, you know, say no more. If you can't find it in tradition, then we don't follow it, ladies and gentlemen. We have to remember,
right.
Scripture and tradition compose the Word of God. And so we can see a clear rupture from tradition. We do not accept this hermeneutics of continuity that the modernists have, because we can clearly demonstrate how they have ruptured from tradition. And, and furthermore, if I can follow that up with a quote from the Archbishop himself. He says this: the church is destroying herself by the path of obedience, quote-unquote obedience. The masterstroke of Satan is thus to spread the principles of revolution from within the church and under the authority of the church itself. He has succeeded in getting those whose duty it is to defend and propagate the church to condemn those who are defending the Catholic faith.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he goes on to say, now our disobedience is motivated by the need to keep the faith. The orders being given us clearly express that they are given to us in order to oblige us to submit without reserve to the Second Vatican Council, the post-conciliar reforms, and the prescriptions of the Holy See. That is to say, to the orientations and acts which are undermining our faith and destroying the church. It is impossible for us to do this, to collaborate in this destruction of the church and to betray the church and to betray our Lord, as Tony mentioned. And he finishes with this. We have to remember, now all the theologians worthy of this name to teach that if a pope by his acts destroy the church, we cannot obey him. We have Suarez, Bellarmine, just two, to, you know, he lists several here, but I'm just going to name those two. You know, that is our duty, ladies and gentlemen, is to resist and to openly resist. It's not to go, quietly and not demonstrate to these individuals who are not following the faith, because it does determine our salvation. And so I'll let you continue, Tony.
Sure. So let's move on to, you know, in more detail, what exactly the Archbishop stood for and why he resisted. Your listeners may ask, well, what's all the hoopla about the Second Vatican Council and afterwards? Well, the modernists that Pope St. Pius X warned about in his encyclical Pascendi Dominici Gregis were able to slowly resurface and take over the council.
Yeah.
Now, for your listeners that don't know, modernism is a heresy that teaches fundamentally that there is no absolute truth.
Yeah.
That truth evolves over time. So in this crisis, we're not dealing with just one heresy, which of itself is bad enough, as in the time of the Arian crisis, where the divinity of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, was denied. But rather, we're dealing with the very foundation of dogma being pulled from underneath it. Because if truth evolves over time, then no dogma is stable, yeah. Right? Dogma changes.
Sure.
So this heresy of modernism is so terrible that Pope St. Pius X did not hesitate to call it the synthesis of all heresies. So this modernism, or let's say more specifically neo-modernism, by the time of the Second Vatican Council, it won the day, unfortunately, at that council. And as a result, the Second Vatican Council became the doctrinal foundation for a new religion, thereby giving birth to what is known amongst traditional Catholics, faithful to the Archbishop, as the Conciliar Church. Or more appropriately, like I call it, the conciliar sect, of which the person of the Pope is the head, while maintaining as Pope his leadership of the true Catholic Church. Now, this term conciliar church, Eric, was actually first heard by the Archbishop in a letter dated June 25th, 1976, written by Bishop Giovanni Benelli, the then deputy of the Secretary of State of Pope Paul VI. And he wrote this letter on behalf of the Pope. And part of the letter states the following. If the seminarians of Icone are of good will and seriously prepared for a priestly ministry in true fidelity to the conciliar church,
yeah.
We will take it upon ourselves to find the best solution for him. So in regards to this conciliar church, Archbishop Lefebvre, having been sanctioned by a suspension ad divinis for having ordained the candidates to the priesthood on June 29, 1976, he wrote of the same year, on July 29th, quote, what can be more clear? In the future, one must obey and be faithful to the conciliar church and no longer to the Catholic Church. This is precisely our problem. We are suspended ad divinis by the conciliar church and for the conciliar church of which we do not want to be a part. This conciliar church is schismatic because she breaks away from the Catholic Church of all times with new dogmas, a new priesthood, new institutions, and a new form of worship already condemned by the church in many official and definitive documents.
Yeah.
So after that, several defenders of Catholic tradition made some comments about this conciliar church. One of them was Jean Madrin, who was a traditionalist writing for a magazine called Itinéraires. I think I pronounced that properly.
Okay.
And he said, quote, that there be at the present time two churches with the one and the same, Paul VI, at the head of both, we can do nothing about it. We are not inventing anything. We remark that such is the case. And then another writer of the same magazine, along with a Father Bruckberger, in the March 18, 1976 edition, he publicly pointed out, quote, The religious crisis no longer consists, as in the 16th century, in having simultaneously two or three popes for one church. The crisis today is to have one pope for two churches, the Catholic Church and the post-conciliar church. End of quote. So we can see, Eric, here that this term conciliar church did not even come from Archbishop Lefebvre. It was actually said by one of the bishops who was trying to convince Archbishop Lefebvre to accept the conciliar church. Yeah. And then after that, you know, it's a very complicated issue. It's not easy to understand. Okay, you have one pope over two churches. We have to be clear that the office of pope belongs to the Catholic Church. It does not belong anywhere else.
Sure.
But the person of the pope, in this case in the conciliar church, while he retains his papacy for the Catholic Church, the person of the pope can also be the head of a false church, and that's exactly what we have today. Okay.
Yeah, I would add, if I could add one point to that. You know, I've talked about this with other priests, Father Perez. You know, from my perspective, the whole notion of the diabolical disorientation—that's where people get confused, because you have, this council and the subsequent popes teaching this new religion, but giving it the label of Catholic, right? Because they still think under their term, so to speak. We have to remember that these modernists, they have this erroneous notion of living tradition, that it evolves inside man, and as the modern man and modern world turns, that doctrines can basically turn. Then also another key piece to that element is this whole notion of search for truth. I know when I was investigating and reading what the popes had said in some of their messages, not even in encyclicals, but just in their local messages when they were traveling, they would always use that term. You know, we're still on the hunt for truth. No, we are not, ladies and gentlemen. We have the truth in the Catholic Church. Now, the reason why that's put in there is because when they soon unite all religions formally, they'll now say, well, we have the truth, right? Because it's evolving. And that's what's truth to these heretics, is that all religions and all humanity are essentially equal. And by the way, that's written into the text of the Second Vatican Council, where it says the church is a sign or a symbol of the unity of the whole human family. That that is heresy beyond heresy. And so my point is, without digressing, is, you know, just following up on what Tony had said, it's confusing people, because, you know, the popes are handing us a glass of water with a label on it that says Coke on it, and they ask us to drink it, and we say, wow, that's wonderful water, Your Holiness. He says, no, it's not, it's Coke. Can't you see the label? It's Coke. Well, no, clearly it's water. You see, it's something different than what they're saying, and they don't get that. So, for lack of a better term, I know Bishop Williamson has used this, but it's mind rot. They have an erroneous perception of what it is to be Catholic, who's in the church, the nature of the church, and then all these other terms that we use as Catholics, such as peace, love even. They have this new concept now called sharing, which is nothing less than socialism. These are all new concepts which we clearly, you know, we have to regard as novelty, and we cannot accept as Catholics. So I'm really glad that you're hitting on this topic of the conciliar church, and I'll let you continue, Tony.
Sure. Continuing with that exact concept, like I said, it's different priests and different people have tried to understand it, and it's definitely not easy to understand, because it really has never happened before. Well, there's an editorial in a magazine called Le Sel de la Terre. It's issue number 59 for the winter of 2006-2007. And this is published by the Dominicans of Avrier in France. And it's, quote, it says in this magazine regarding the conciliar church, it says, there's one hierarchy for two churches. And in explaining the four causes of a society, this magazine defined the conciliar church in this way, quote, it is the conciliar church is the society of those who are baptized and who submit themselves to the directives of the present pope and bishops in their desire to promote conciliar ecumenism, and who thus admit the teachings of Vatican II, the new liturgy, and the new code of canon law, unquote. And then afterwards, the editorial answered the objections, quote, but it's not possible that the same hierarchy direct two churches, unquote, because if one is in charge of a church other than the Catholic Church, one apostatizes. If the Pope is in charge of another church, he is no longer Pope, and then one falls into sedevacantism. But the objection to this is as follows. Quote, the objection's error is to imagine the conciliar church as a society that formally imposes schism or heresy as the Orthodox or Protestants do. For example, if I adhere to the Anglican Church, I am formally a schismatic and even a heretic, and therefore I am no longer a member of the Catholic Church. Yet, I can be conciliar, that is to say ecumenical, and still keep the Catholic faith. Without doubt, I do put my faith in danger and that of others, but I do not immediately abjure it. Hence, the members of the hierarchy, provided that they do not push their errors to the point of denying the Catholic faith, remain members of the Catholic hierarchy, even though they are conciliar, unquote. And it's important to understand that, an objection against the sedevacantist claim.
Sure.
Well, the popes have not formally said, you know, we've adopted this conciliar church, and I no longer want anything to do with the Catholic Church. That's not what they said.
Yeah.
In their minds, the Catholic Church and the conciliar church are the same thing.
Yeah.
The conciliar church is a continuation of the Catholic Church. So there's no formal heresy on their part.
Yeah, right? Manifest heretics, as the Diamond Brothers, you know, there is no formal manifest heresy there. And that's why I always use the argument, Tony, when I talk with these sedevacantists, you know, you have to read what the conciliars say themselves. They say, no, hermeneutics of continuity. So clearly they think what they're teaching is in line with tradition, and yet it's not.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. That's right. So the question we answer now, we move to is, well, what did the Archbishop stand for? Well, seeing the fight that he had all these years, he stood basically for the preservation of everything Catholic during the time of crisis, from the priesthood, the Mass, the sacraments, and most importantly, the Catholic faith. People have to understand that the Catholic faith comes first. Everything comes from the Catholic faith, the priesthood, the Mass, the sacraments. If you don't have the faith, the other things, you know, it's like going to step two before you go to step one.
Right.
Okay? You got to follow the order that God has given. And basically, it was the Second Vatican Council that kicked these things into high gear away from the Catholic Church and towards the conciliar church. Now, Eric, as Catholics, you know, we firmly believe that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ founded only one church, the Catholic Church, and that all are bound to enter her bosom. And if those who do not enter her, and it's their fault that they don't, they will be condemned to hell for all eternity. Many in the Novus Ordo don't want to accept that. So really, the Archbishop, you really had no choice. You really had no choice but to resist the changes that resulted from the Second Vatican Council, for the glory of God first and foremost, and then for the salvation of souls, including his own. As a matter of fact, not only did the Archbishop resist after the council, he resisted at the council sessions as well.
Yeah.
He has a book entitled, I Accuse the Council, and in this book he details in his interventions during the council sessions. So then, what was so bad about the Second Vatican Council? Well, there are three key areas that we can concentrate on that the Archbishop most firmly resisted, and that's ecumenism, collegiality, and religious liberty. So starting off first, let's move to ecumenism.
Sure.
The dogmas of the Catholic faith teach us that she is the one true Church of Christ, that she is the sole ark of salvation, that she is the one holy Catholic and apostolic church, that she is the mystical body of Jesus Christ, as taught in Mystici Corporis of the encyclical of Pope Pius XII. Well, Vatican II obscured these truths, starting with one of the council documents called Lumen Gentium. In paragraph 8 of this document, it states the following, quote, this Church of Christ, constituted and organized in the world as a society, subsists in the Catholic Church, which is governed by the successor of Peter and by the bishops in communion with him, although many elements of sanctification and truth are found outside of its visible structure. These elements, as gifts belonging to the Church of Christ, are forces impelling towards Catholic unity. End of quote. The Catholic Church has always taught that she and the Church of Christ are one and the same thing.
Right.
They are identical. It's like saying one equals one.
Uh-huh.
Well, this paragraph that I just quoted to you of Lumen Gentium obscured this truth by using the term subsists rather than the traditional is. Well, a thing that subsists in another is not identical to it. Subsist means to underlie or to give existence to something. For example, we can say that God subsists in a tree. That is, he gave and continues to sustain its existence. But this does not mean to say that God and the tree are the same thing. Otherwise, this would be tantamount to pantheism. Well, the term subsist, when applied to the relationship of the Church of Christ to the Catholic Church, poses a problem because the same Church of Christ can be said to subsist in other false churches, such as in the various sects, like the Anglicans, for example.
Right.
And this is said to, the relationship is said to happen on account, according to Vatican II, on account of elements of sanctification, for example, baptism, the sacrament of baptism, and elements of truth, for example, that Jesus Christ is God, which are also found in these Protestant sects. However, properly speaking, these elements belong solely to the Catholic Church. Our Lord gave them to the Catholic Church for her use and dispensation. So when an Anglican minister, Eric, for example, baptizes a baby, that minister actually commits a mortal sin.
Yeah.
Because he's not authorized to use that sacrament. Now, other than in cases of danger and death, in which the church gives the authority to administer the sacrament to anybody with the correct intention and who uses the correct matter and form, that's fine. But that's, we're not speaking about that here. We're speaking about here as the Anglican sect or the Anglican church as the Anglican church. As representatives of the Anglican Church, they have no right to use these sacraments outside of the church's authority. Okay? To highlight the problem between the use of the terms is and subsists, here are the words of the former Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, who, by the way, was intimately associated with this subject because he was an expert theologian at the Second Vatican Council. This is quoted from an interview he gave to a German newspaper called Frankfurter Allgemeine.
Okay.
Quote, Vatican II did not use Pius XII's expression according to which the Roman Catholic Church is the only Church of Christ. Instead, it preferred the expression, the Church of Christ subsists in the Catholic Church, because it, that is, the Second Vatican Council, wished to affirm that the being of the church as such is a larger identity than the Roman Catholic Church. Here's Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger stating this at the time that he was the prefect for the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, the doctrinal watchdog, right? Here's another quote that Joseph Ratzinger gave in the April the 3rd, 2000 edition of the Osservatorium Romano. Quote, the council distanced itself from Pius XII, who had said that the Catholic Church is the unique mystical body of Christ. It is the difference between the subsists and the is of Pius XII that the whole ecumenical problem lies. Right? Here's another quote. Now, this is coming, an official document coming from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, which was dated June 29, 2007. Once again, Cardinal Ratzinger, being the head of the prefect at that time. Quote, it is possible, according to Catholic doctrine, to affirm correctly that the Church of Christ is present and operative in the churches and ecclesial communities not yet in full communion with the Catholic Church, on account of the elements of sanctification and truth that are present in them. So clearly these quotes show that the term subsists was purposely put there to allow this crack in the door.
Yeah.
Right? And of course, to a Catholic, these are not acceptable. We will not accept anything but the Church of Christ equals the Catholic Church, period. Now, why was this done? Well, Lumen Gentium was considered the doctrinal background for future decrees in the council later on.
Mm-hmm.
And this Lumen Gentium quotes that I gave you, the quote I gave you in basically provided this crack in the door to a decree the decree of ecumenism called Redintegratio Unitatis. Okay? And in paragraph 4 of this decree, here is the ecumenical movement is defined as such. Quote, the term ecumenical movement indicates the initiatives and activities planned and undertaken according to the various needs of the church and as opportunities offer to promote Christian unity. So that's what it's about. It's about Christian unity. Continue. These are, first, every effort to avoid expressions, judgments and actions which do not represent the condition of our separated brethren with truth and fairness, and so make mutual relations with them more difficult. Then dialogue between competent experts from different churches and committees. At these meetings, which are organized in a religious spirit, each explains the teaching of his communion in greater depth and brings out clearly its distincts and features. So in such dialogue, everyone gains a truer knowledge and a more just appreciation of the teaching and religious life of both communions. In addition, the way is prepared for cooperation between them in the duties for the common good of humanity. How many times have we heard that, Eric?
Yeah, Freemasonry.
And to continue, it says these the duties for the common good of humanity, which are demanded by every Christian conscience. And wherever this is allowed, there is prayer in common. It's right there, prayer in common.
Yeah, that's heresy.
Finally,
yeah.
That's heresy. Finally, all are led to examine their own faithfulness to Christ's will for the church and accordingly to undertake with vigor the task of renewal and reform. End of quote. Now, nowhere does this decree on ecumenism speak about seeking the conversion of those outside the Catholic Church to the Catholic Church.
Right.
Which is exactly the reason why Catholics should reach out to the others. That is, to bring them into the Catholic Church. But instead, what do we have here? We just have this dialogue where we each meet and, you know, you tell me about your faith and I'll tell you about mine and let's work for the common good of humanity.
Yeah.
It's exactly what we're seeing today and what we've been seeing since the Vatican Council, really.
Yeah, and that's exactly what Tony's trying to say, ladies and gentlemen, is we have what Tony has just described is the platform and a foundation for a new church. These modernists have a completely different concept of what is Catholic, who's in the quote-unquote Catholic Church, because their Catholic means universal, and their idea of universal is Masonic. Let's just be honest with you. It's a Masonic concept. It's not Catholic concept. I wanted to add a few more points while you were talking.
Sure.
With this notion of conciliar church, even with Pope John Paul II, he followed that up, and I believe it was Redemptor Hominis. I don't have it in front of me, but just off the top of my head, he called the conciliar church, he called it the Church of the New Advent. He didn't even call it the Catholic Church, the Church of the New Advent. Now, I don't want to be a part of that church. And then what I also wanted to focus in on, and Pope St. Pius X clearly laid this out, these heretics who are bringing about this formal one world religion, these heretics focus in on what would unite us and disregard that which would separate us. So again, as Tony mentioned, the conciliar church, these modernist heretics have the understanding of ecumenists to go out and dialogue when it's not about conversion. To them, it's about dialogue, convergence, and coexistence. It has nothing to do with convert to the Catholic Church. And if you don't believe me, go and read the Bellarmine Agreement, 1993. John Paul II, I think he was reaching out to the Greeks, correct me if I'm wrong, Tony, I think it was the Greek Orthodox, and he said, conversion to the church is outdated ecclesiology. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's clear their concept of the church is wrong. Their concept of who's even in the church is wrong. It's very much universalism, and even some of the Freemasons, I think,
Yves Congar?
Yeah, Yves Congar. Yeah. Some of these, they've openly come out and praised John the 23rd and Paul the 6th for their universalism. So that's what we're saying here, ladies and gentlemen. This is a new church. This conciliar church, objectively speaking, is not the Catholic Church. And it's leading people into the formal New Age religion, which will be solidified, in my opinion, here very soon. I want to keep you going here, Tony. I know you got a lot more for us, but I just wanted to add those points.
Sure, anytime. Intercede anytime, Eric.
Okay.
Let's move now. Let's hear the true Catholic teaching regarding conversion, okay, from the words of Pope Leo XIII in his encyclical, Satis Cognitum, which is on the unity of the church. In paragraph 3, he says, quote, "And since it was necessary that his, that is Jesus Christ's, divine mission should be perpetuated to the end of time, he took to himself disciples, trained by himself, and made them partakers of his own authority." He made them partakers of his own authority. "And when he had invoked upon them from heaven the Spirit of truth, he bade them to go through the whole world and faithfully preach to all nations what he had taught and what he had commanded, so that by the profession of his doctrine and the observance of his laws, the human race might attain to holiness on earth and never-ending happiness in heaven. In this wise and on this principle, the church was begotten." That's the reason why the church was begotten, unquote. And then later in the same paragraph, Pope Leo the 13 continues, quote, "Jesus Christ commanded his apostles and their successors to the end of time to teach and rule the nations. He ordered the nations to accept their teaching and obey their authority," end of quote. So we can see here by this quote that the purpose of the church is to save souls. It's to take souls who are outside her fold and bring them in, so that they not only can attain holiness on earth, but for in the end, for the purpose of never-ending happiness in heaven, right?
Sure.
Now, in paragraph 3 of this decree of ecumenism, it basically points out why there is no real need to see conversions, according to Vatican II. It says, quote, "It follows that the separated churches and communities as such, though we believe them to be deficient in some respects, have been by no means deprived of significance and importance in the mystery of salvation. For the Spirit of Christ has not refrained from using them as means of salvation."
Heresy.
Which derive their efficacy from the very fullness of grace and truth entrusted to the church. Unquote. So you can see here why basically ecumenism is basically saying, look, the Catholic Church is the best church, but you know the church you're in is not deprived of a sanctification.
Yeah.
Well, that's why we have people today saying, "Why should I enter the church?
Right?
I can be saved in my own religion." Well, let's hear what the Archbishop, in his book They Have Crowned Him, let's hear what he wrote about this exact statement. He said, quote, "The Council took pleasure in exalting the salvific values, or the value of other religions. Now, speaking of the non-Catholic, quote-unquote, Christian religions, Vatican II teaches that, although we believe them to be victims of deficiencies, they are not in any way devoid of meaning and value in the mystery of salvation. This is heresy. The only means of salvation is the Catholic Church. Insofar as they are separated from the unity of the true faith, the Protestant communions cannot be used by the Holy Ghost. He can only act directly on souls or make use of the means, for example, baptism, which in and of themselves do not bear any indication of separation. One can be saved in Protestantism, but not by Protestantism. In heaven, there are no Protestants. There are only Catholics." End of quote.
Right, yeah.
So the true missionary activity of the church, that is, what she has done for centuries, is seeking the conversion of non-Catholic Christians. This idea is dead in Vatican II. And here's another statement from Vatican II, another different document called Ad Gentes, paragraph 6. Listen to this. Quote, "Thus it is plain that missionary activity wells up from the church's inner nature and spreads abroad her saving faith. It perfects her Catholic unity by this expansion. It is sustained by her apostolicity. It exercises the collegial spirit of her hierarchy. It bears witness to sanctity while spreading and promoting it. Thus," and now here's the part that I put in bold, "thus, missionary activity among the nations differs from pastoral activity exercised among the faithful, as well as from undertakings aimed at restoring unity amongst Christians." You read that?
Yeah.
So what is it saying here? It's basically saying that missionary activity among nations is differs from undertakings aimed at restoring unity amongst Christians. So it's not part of the goal of missionary activity to restore unity amongst Christians. In other words, missionary activity does not involve this restoration of unity.
Right.
But that's completely different than what the church has always done. Yeah. Right. The church has not only worked to bring those who are not Christian at all, but to bring also, especially since the schism and since the Protestant Revolution, to bring them back into the church as well.
Sure.
Right. So, you know, the Vatican II teaching, on the other hand, it just doesn't seek the conversion of non-Catholic, quote-unquote, Christians. Well, you might ask why. Well, unfortunately, in the conciliar church, they basically see baptism between Catholics and non-Catholic, quote-unquote, Christians as the base for unity. And we know, Eric, that baptism is necessary
sure.
to make you a member of the church, but it's not sufficient. Okay, there are other essential elements. For example, accepting the Pope as the head of the church. As we know, the Orthodox and the Protestants don't do that.
Right.
So we can't pick and choose here. You either accept the faith as a whole, or you reject it as a whole. You reject one, you reject everything.
Yeah, right? that's in Scripture. It's James 2:10, I think. When you depart from one, I'm paraphrasing here. When you depart from one part of the law, you put yourself outside of the whole of the law. And that's why heresy is not only mortal sin, but it separates you from the body. And that's why Archbishop Lefebvre never accepted this council. I know early on it was a little wishy-washy, and that's what the neo-SXPX is trying to put their propaganda out and get people to think that this is the way he really was the whole time for this agreement. But, you know, in the end, for the most of the time, and especially before he died, he said this. He said, the Second Vatican Council reform, since it has issued from liberalism and come from modernism, is entirely corrupt. It comes from heresy and results in heresy, even if all of its acts are not formally heretical. It is thus impossible for any Catholic who is aware of these things to adopt this reform or to submit to it in any way at all. To ensure our salvation, the only attitude of fidelity to the Church and to Christ and to Catholic doctrine is a categorical refusal of the reform. And that's the reason why I say that, is because that's what separates us from, I'd label them pseudo-traditionalists. I guess other people, you know, they label them indults. I mean, it separates mm-hmm. us from the remnant crowd, from the FSSP crowd. We cannot accept this council, because even if there's 2% heresy, 1% heresy, the council needs to go away. It's right. poisonous as a whole. And furthermore, Archbishop Lefebvre went on to say about the council. These are important points here, because we have to know who really, you know, who Archbishop Lefebvre was really, not how he's being painted right now by some in the, you know, the pseudo-trad groups. He says, some say the council was good and has good, but only the reform is bad. But that is not true. Why? Because when Rome gave the reform, they always say, the reforms they do in the name of the council. In the name of the council, emphatically he says that, it is evident that all the reform came from the council and the reform is bad. It is impossible that the council is good and all the reforms are bad, right? Don't we hear this? The whole spirit yeah. of Vatican II argument by the remnant. Well, you know, the spirit behind it is bad, but the texts are good. Baloney. A bad mm-hmm. spirit, a worldly, however you want to say it, a worldly spirit, spirit of man, spirit of the devil, cannot produce sound and orthodox documents. He right. says, I don't accept the council because you are destroying the Catholic state in the name of the council. It is sure, it is evident. This council gives the same rights to error as to truth. And I don't want to go too much further because I know you're going to talk about this, but he says it's impossible. This is a new faith. It is a new religion. Ultimately, it's Protestantism. You know, this is a fact. And he was so emphatic, you know, in saying these things. And I know sometimes people paint Archbishop Lefebvre as a pacifist, and surely, you know, he was very pious, but I mean, he was very adamant in a lot of the things he said, Tony.
Yeah, very true. So just to conclude this part on ecumenism, you know, from my reading of the council documents on this topic, I basically have come to the conclusion that the ultimate goal of ecumenism as sought by the Second Vatican Council and the documents emanating after that is basically this unity, but it's really a unity of fellowship amongst Christians on earth. It's rather humanistic than supernatural, whereas the church, yes, it does look out for the temporal well-being of its members, but That's not the most important thing. The most important thing is the salvation of souls.
Yeah, right? Faith. It's ultimately the next faith.
Now compare, Vatican II to this simple question in the Revised Baltimore Catechism number 3, which was published in 1949, 15 years before the council ended. Question 166 asks, are all obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved? Answer, all are obliged to belong to the Catholic Church in order to be saved. Very simple, simple and straightforward.
Yeah.
Instead, the Second Vatican Council says everything but. Unfortunately, like you said, that one heresy has to be, it basically makes the whole council null and void.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, moving to the next major topic, I don't want to speak too much on this. It's collegiality. Basically, Eric, collegiality is, it's basically a democratization of the hierarchy of the church, where the Pope is no longer seen so much as a monarch with supreme jurisdiction over the whole church, as defined by the First Vatican Council, but more of a first among equals. And this collegiality has triggered down to dioceses where, bishops, priests, and laity all have councils, right? And everybody takes a vote on everything, right? It's not the way it was before. Perhaps someone can correct me on this point, but I think of these three, that is ecumenism, collegiality, and religious liberty, collegiality was probably the least important for the archbishop. So what I'd like to do, just unless you have any questions on this or want to expand on this,
well, I just want to
move on to religious liberty.
Yeah, I just wanted to make one point, and this is just solely my opinion on this. Part of the reason why that is in place, and from my perspective, I take the opinion of Father Martin, I'm sure Archbishop Lefebvre said this somewhere, but also Father Hess, the texts in Vatican II were purposely put there. Listen, they weren't, they weren't theologians who were just off the mark. There's a plan in place to get men into this formal New Age religion, and Vatican II was that platform. Now, for me, collegiality, soon in the world, you're going to see someone who shows up, who's not going to call himself Pope, but he's going to be a presider over the Christian churches. This is very much in New Age writings, which I know, for those of you who've been following my work, I try to expose these individuals. I want to put that in there. And the reason why that's important, because he's going to be seen as a first amongst equals. He doesn't want to be called Pope. And that's why you see that propaganda being laid down, why you see Francis saying, I don't want to be called Pope, I just want to be called Bishop of Rome or whatever. And you see a lot of that propaganda already being laid down in train tracks for this individual to show up, and he's going to unite quote unquote humanity. I just wanted to add that in there, because to me it's very diabolical. It's not just, it wasn't just put in there and it was just bad theology. I mean, it was put in there purposely because they knew the end game. They knew what was going to happen, whatever, 50 plus years down the road where we're at now.
For sure. It's definitely the devil's work, and to claim that it's just simply a mistake or, people just playing around with the theology of the church. No, there is definitely a plan to lead people to hell.
Yeah.
I mean, sure. What it really comes down to. So let's move to the third part now. And this part is religious liberty. There was a declaration of the council called Dignitatis Humanae. And this document is very important because it touches the life of man as a social creature, living in society. And the Archbishop was very, I think this was probably the issue that was hit home most to him, in the sense of him seeing it as a very damaging doctrine.
Sure.
And basically, the following summarizes the key false proposition of this document. And that is that man has the natural right not to be restrained from acting in accordance with his conscience in public, especially in religious matters, provided that the just public order is observed. So that's it in a nutshell. But this is false, because man does not have a natural right not to be restrained from acting in accordance with his conscience in public, regardless of the conditions or regardless of the circumstances. If his conscience is not in accordance with the truth attained by reason and divine revelation. Now, if his conscience is in accordance with truth, if he has the truth, if he has the Catholic faith, then of course, then he has a natural right, because we have a right to the truth and we have a right to live according to the truth.
Right.
But religious liberty this declaration at the council is saying that even if you're an heir, basically, it doesn't explicitly say this, but it's implied that, you know, you can propagate your religion in public.
Yeah, the Vatican actually comes back and they say, well, we're not giving you a license to heir, but as you said, it's implied. I mean, if you use your brain, it's implied that when you give, you know, heir public rights, that's the result.
Correct. Exactly. Now, the Archbishop actually intervened at the Second Vatican Council on September 1965, as recorded in his book, I Accuse the Council. And the following intervention was read to all the Council Fathers, okay? So bear with me. The quote's a little bit long, but I think it's good to see, you know, the Archbishop's words.
Okay.
Quote, Venerable Fathers, it seems to me that the principle of the Declaration on Religious Liberty could be briefly expressed as follows. Founded on the dignity of the human person, religious liberty demands equal rights in civil society for all forms of worship, even Satanism.
Yeah.
Society must then be neutral and guarantee the protection of every religion within the limits of public order. Such is the conception of religious liberty proposed to us by those who drafted this declaration. Is this conception new, or has it already been received clear support over many centuries? The writer himself has answered this question. On page 43, he writes, quote, A fairly long historical evolution, both moral and positive, has led to this conception of religious liberty, which has been enforced only since the 18th century, unquote. This is now the Archbishop talking again. Such an admission destroys ipso facto the whole line of argument of the Declaration. Where, in point of fact, did this conception come into force? In the tradition of the Church or outside the Church? Clearly, it made its appearance among the self-styled philosophers of the 18th century, such as Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, Voltaire. In the name of the dignity of human reason, they tried to destroy the Church by causing the massacre of innumerable bishops, priests, religious, and laity. In the middle of the 19th century, with Lamennais, the liberal Catholics attempted to reconcile this conception with the Church doctrine. So now we see that this idea of liberty started to enter the Church in the middle of the 19th century. And this was condemned by Pope Pius IX. To continue, this conception, which in his encyclical Immortale Dei, Pope Leo XIII calls a new law, was solemnly condemned by that pontiff as contrary to sound philosophy and against Holy Scripture and tradition. I repeat, against Holy Scripture and tradition. This same conception, this new law, so many times condemned by the Church, the Conciliar Commission of Vatican II is now asking us to subscribe to and countersign. It is in the name of this same conception, in the name of the dignity of the human person, that the communists wish to force all men down to atheism and justify their persecution of every religion. In the name of safeguarding public order, a number of countries are nationalizing the Church's schools and institutions in order to create political unity. Jesus Christ himself was crucified in the name of public order and in the name of that same order. All the martyrs have suffered their tortures. This conception of religious liberty is that of the Church's enemies.
Yeah.
End of quote. So you can see, Eric, I mean, this is exactly what we see has happened to the United States, has happened to Canada, and most of the Western world, right? In the name of religious liberty. And that continues, I mean, really, when you see attacks on religious liberty, what do the church hierarchy do right now? Instead of resorting to say only the Catholic Church has the right to promulgate its faith, instead they use the concept of religious liberty as taught in Vatican II to justify their actions, which is complete nonsense, as I showed you.
Yeah, I was going to say, in a sense, I've always argued this, it's kind of like problem, reaction, solution. It actually makes the new religion stronger, right? You have supposed, on the right hand, you know, Marxists or communists, coming down on those preaching religious liberty, and then these bishops will get behind it and say, yeah, everyone's got the right to religion. And so they're only pushing the new religion even further. And you see a lot of these rallies, as you mentioned. I see people going out there together, you know, with Protestants and Buddhists. Yeah, you've got a religious liberty. Let's pray together. And it's like, really? Listen, ladies and gentlemen, we are in a sad hour when, you know, Archbishop Lefebvre, really, he really summed it up. You know, in the end, he said, I have never changed. I've preached and done what the church has always taught. I've never changed what the church said at the Council of Trent or at the First Vatican Council, which was dogmatic, by the way. Second Vatican Council was not. So who has changed? It is the enemy, he said, as reiterated by Pope St. Pius X. It's the enemy who is working inside the church. We have to remember Pope St. Pius X said that in 1907, that the church's enemies were inside her bosom in 1907. And they want to finish the church off, and they want to put an end to tradition and dogmatism. Ladies and gentlemen, when we arrive at an hour, when you quote scripture, and I say this all the time, especially on Twitter, I'll literally quote the scripture, I think it's 1 Thessalonians 2:14-16 on the Jews, which states the Jews are accursed for killing Jesus. The wrath has come down them, you know, upon no end. And you go and say that to someone in the Novus Ordo, even a priest, and they look at you like you have three heads. You know what I'm saying? So that's what I'm saying. They're in a completely new religion and they don't even realize it. And it's, you know, what else can we, you know, what else can happen other than chastisement, Tony? I mean, this is what we deserve. People don't want the truth anymore. They want to just keep moving along. And we're just trying to remember a future saint who stood solidly on what the church has always said and resisted publicly.
That's right. Very good. To continue on this religious liberty, the Archbishop wrote another book called They Have Uncrowned Him, Him Being Jesus Christ. The Archbishop here shows in one area the difference between the teaching of Pope Pius IX in Quanta Cura and the teaching of Vatican II on religious liberty. Here is the teaching of Pope Pius IX. This proposition is condemned. The best condition of society is that in which there is not conceded to the authorities the duty to repress the violators of the Catholic religion by legal penalties, except when the public peace demands this. This is condemned. What does Vatican II teach? On the contrary, in religious matters, let no one be impeded from acting according to his conscience, yeah, in private or in public, alone or associated with others within just limits.
All right.
Here's another teaching condemned by Quanta Cura. Quote, liberty of conscience and all forms of worship is a right proper to every man. That's condemned. What does Vatican II teach? The person has a right to religious liberty. This liberty consists on so on and so on. And then a third teaching here to continue. Quote, this liberty of conscience must be proclaimed and guaranteed in every correctly established society. That is condemned by Quanta Cura. But what does Vatican II teach? This right of the human person to religious liberty must be recognized in the juridical order of society in such a manner that it constitutes a civil right. You see why now Rome went down to Colombia and told them, you know, you got to remove the Catholic religion is the only true religion out of your constitution. Yeah. Because you know what? Your constitution has to reflect the fact that all the other religions also have the same right. So it's just, it's the Vatican itself who is working to destroy the faith. It's just incredible.
Yeah, and it really goes to show, as I've said before, you know, in my study of Freemasonry, I have a rather, you know, lengthy background in it. When you study any lodge, you can go right now and look at any Masonic lodge, especially here in America, and look at their fundamental principles, and you will see the right to religious liberty and liberty of conscience right there in front of you, ladies and gentlemen. So if you want to know who has infiltrated the church, it's Judeo-Freemasonry. These are principles which have, in many cases, been infallibly condemned. They're not just mere mistakes, as some pseudo-traditionalists try to make it seem. And I would argue right now, with everything that I've seen and read, that they're literally promoting the Vatican about 80, maybe even 90% overall of Freemasonry. And a classic example is this. We know from Scripture that once you change philosophy, it leads to erroneous doctrine. When you change your philosophy, it'll lead to doctrine. And I believe that was Paul again off the top of my head. But we have now at Vatican II, as a basis for the of the new philosophy, is this new or integral humanism, right? So what are the fruits of this new or integral humanism? As I've said, awesome. often, religious liberty, liberty of conscience. We've already talked about ecumenism. There's also freedom of press, freedom of speech, and a few others, you know, off the top of my head. Separation of church and state is another. Americanism, that's another heresy. Okay, mm-hmm. Well, this is all the things that either Vatican II has taught or it's being taught by the popes subsequently. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's what I'm saying. They're literally teaching Freemasonry, passing it off as Catholicism, saying you must obey, and we know as Catholics we can't. We're trying to speak in layman's terms here, but this is where the infiltration has come from. Go ahead, Tony.
Okay, the fundamental effect of this Declaration on Religious Liberty is really nothing less than the uncrowning of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as the King of Public Life. Now, let's listen again to the words of the Archbishop, again in his book, They Have Uncrowned Him. Quote, "Now, if the state no longer recognizes in itself a singular duty towards the true religion of the true God, the common good of civil society is no longer ordered to the heavenly city of the blessed. And the city of God on earth, that is to say, the church, finds itself deprived of all its beneficial and unique influence on all of public life. Whether one wants it or not, social life is organized outside the truth, outside the divine law. Society becomes atheistic. This is the death of the social reign of our Lord Jesus Christ." End of quote. So let's compare this now, what Vatican II teaches about the social reign of Jesus Christ. Well, it doesn't actually mention the social reign, but the fact that it promotes religious liberty destroys the social reign, as I mentioned. Well, here is Pope Pius XII in his great encyclical, Quas Primas, which is on the social kingship of Jesus Christ. He says, quote, "The empire of our Redeemer embraces all men. To use the words of our immortal predecessor, Pope Leo XIII, this is not Pope Leo being quoted, "His empire includes not only Catholic nations, not only baptized persons who, though of right belonging to the church, have been led astray by error or have been cut off from her by schism, but also all those who are outside the Catholic faith, so that truly the whole of mankind is subject to the power of Jesus Christ." You know what I say to that, Eric? Deo gracias.
Yeah.
That's a pope telling us where our Lord's position should be in public life. It should be, everybody should be bending their knee, whether it's the, you know, Prime Minister of Canada, whether it's the President of the United States, doesn't matter. They all should bend their knee to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Now, Eric, I want to move on to, I know we're running a little bit out of time here, just to go quickly here through the reforms that happen or follow Vatican II. The biggest one, the one that has caused the most problem of conscience to many people, is the Novus Ordo Missae.
Sure.
And the new rite of Mass. And let's again see a quote from Archbishop Lefebvre. Quote, "This Mass, that is the Novus Ordo Mass, is not bad in a merely accidental or extrinsic way. There is something in it that is truly bad. It was based on the model of the Mass according to Cranmer and Thays, 1959.
Yeah.
As I said in Rome to those who interviewed me, it's a poison Mass." End of quote. Here's another quote. Quote, "The new Mass, even when said with piety and respect for the liturgical rules, is subject to the same reservations since it is impregnated with the spirit of Protestantism. It bears within it a poison harmful to the faith." End of quote. Here's another quote. Quote, "I will never celebrate the Mass according to the new rite, even under threat of ecclesiastical penalties. And when I will never advise anyone positively to participate actively in such a Mass." End of quote. So why did the Archbishop speak this way regarding new Mass? Well, in a study that he helped formulate called the Attaviani intervention,
right,
a short critical study of the new order of Mass, there was a letter that Cardinals Alfredo Attaviano and Antonio Bacci sent to Pope Paul VI just before the new Mass was going to be made official, or I don't want to say made promulgated, because right. some people don't like that term.
Yeah.
Published, let's say, and given the impression that it was required to be used.
Sure.
Here it is in this letter. Quote, the Novus Ordo Missae represents both as a whole and in its details a striking departure from the Catholic theology of the Mass as it was formulated in Session 22 of the Council of Trent. The canons of the rite definitely fixed at that time erected an insurmountable barrier against any heresy which might attack the integrity of the mystery. End of quote. So that, I believe, sums up beautifully that this new Mass is not only in its details, but as a whole, it departs from the Catholic theology of the Mass of the Council of Trent, which was a dogmatic council. So we must reject this new Mass wholesale, and no one, priest, lady, should never ever recommend or approve of, either explicitly or implicitly, attendance at this new Mass. They must stick to the Mass of all time.
Yeah, absolutely, but, Tony. I was going to add too. There's a section on my YouTube called Father Hess. I know Father Kramer's got some good stuff there. Then also Vatican II, where I cover this. So as a follow up to what Tony's saying, ladies and gentlemen, you could go to my YouTube channel, search TradCatKnight, find the Vatican II section, the Father Hess section, and Father Kramer section, where he's going to go into detail on what Tony is talking about, because the new Mass is illicit and it's schismatic, ladies and gentlemen. It's a new order of Mass, which the Council of Trent, Canon 7, Session 13, has clearly said that any of those who step above the boundaries of this of the traditional Latin Rite puts themselves outside the Church, anathema. And, you know, let's not even get into the fact, Tony, that, you know, who was behind, the Concilium with Bunini. And then there was, 10 Protestants, one supposed Catholic and a Jew, I think. It's Protestant. It's Protestantism.
That's right.
I've actually ladies and gentlemen, I've had people come to me from the Protestant sect and say, you know, this new Mass, you know it's Protestant, right? I mean, they've openly admitted to me. And I said, well, yeah, we know that. That's why we don't go to it.
That's right.
But go ahead, Tony.
Well, of course, the attitude that the Archbishop had towards Vatican II and New Mass, well, eventually upset the church hierarchy, such that the French bishops brought complaints against the seminary. And shortly thereafter, the Archbishop felt compelled to write an official declaration, which was a sort of charter of his position, and this charter lasts until his death. This declaration is dated November 21st, 1974, and I'd like to read it all quickly because I think it's important to understand his official position as he stated it. Quote, we hold fast with all our heart and with all our soul to Catholic Rome, guardian of the Catholic faith and the traditions necessary to preserve this faith, to eternal Rome, mistress of wisdom and truth. We refuse, on the other hand, and have always refused to follow the Rome of the neo-modernist and neo-Protestant tendencies, which were clearly evident in the Second Vatican Council and after the Council, in all the reforms which issued from it. All these reforms indeed have contributed and are still contributing to the destruction of the Church, to the ruin of the priesthood, to the abolition of the sacrifice of the Mass and of the sacraments, to the disappearance of religious life, to a naturalist and to Teilhardian teaching in universities, seminaries, and catechetics, a teaching derived from liberalism and Protestantism, many times condemned by the solemn magisterium of the Church. No authority, not even the highest in the hierarchy, can force us to abandon or diminish our Catholic faith, so clearly expressed and professed by the Church's magisterium for 19 centuries. And here the Archbishop quotes St. Paul, but though we, or an angel from heaven, preach a gospel to you besides that which we have preached to you, let him be anathema. Galatians 1:8. The Archbishop continues, is it not this that the Holy Father is repeating to us today? And if we can discern a certain contradiction in his words and deeds, as well as those in the dicasteries, well, we choose what we always taught, and we turn a deaf ear to the novelties destroying the Church. It is impossible to modify profoundly the lex orandi without modifying the lex credendi.
Yeah.
To the Novus Ordo Missae correspond a new catechism, a new priesthood, new seminaries, a charismatic Pentecostal church, all things opposed to orthodoxy and the perennial teaching of the Church. This Reformation, born of liberalism and modernism, is poison through and through. It derives from heresy and ends in heresy, even if all its acts are not formally heretical. It is therefore impossible for any conscientious and faithful Catholic to espouse this Reformation or to submit to it in any way whatsoever. The only attitude of faithfulness to the Church and Catholic doctrine in view of our salvation is a categorical refusal to accept this Reformation. That is why, without any spirit of rebellion, bitterness, or resentment, we pursue our work of forming priests with the timeless magisterium as our guide. We are persuaded that we can render no greater service to the Holy Catholic Church, to the Sovereign Pontiff, and to posterity. That is why we hold fast to all that has been believed and practiced in the faith, morals, liturgy, teaching of the catechism, formation of the priest, and institution of the church, by the church of all time, to all these things as codified in those books which saw day before the modernist influence of the council. This we shall do until such time that the true light of tradition dissipates the darkness obscuring the sky of eternal Rome. By doing this, with the grace of God, and the help of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and that of St. Joseph and St. Pius X, we are assured of remaining faithful to the Roman Catholic Church and to all the successors of Peter, and of being the fidelis dispensatos mysteriorium Domini Nostri Jesu Christi in Spiritu Sancto. Amen. Well, throughout the years, end of quote, throughout the years of this declaration, Eric, the Archbishop tried. He tried to work with the Roman authorities to get them to come back to tradition by having regular contacts with them. But really, it got to a point where he just completely lost trust in them. Therefore, in order to continue Catholic tradition, he decided to consecrate four bishops on June the 30th, 1988. And before his death, he left one last book, especially directed to the priests, in which he wrote, quote, "This conciliar church is imbued with the principles of 1979. These are Masonic principles, as you said, Eric, with respect to religion and religions in general, and with respect to civil society. Its foundation was an imposture inspired by hell for the destruction of the Catholic religion, of its magisterium, of its priesthood, and the sacrifice of our Lord. This new church can no longer sing the praises of Jesus Christ, universal King of nations, can no longer have the thoughts of our Lord with respect to the world. That is why the whole spirit of the liturgy has been modified by the changing of a multitude of details in texts and gestures. It is therefore," this is now, he says this later on in the same book, A Spiritual Journey, quote, "it is therefore a strict duty for every priest wanting to remain Catholic to separate himself from this conciliar church, for as long as it does not rediscover the tradition of the church and of the Catholic faith," end of quote. And the Archbishop remained firm in his position till his death on March the 25th, 1991.
Yeah.
So, Eric, just to end off, going to part three here, well, what would the Archbishop have said, you know, of what is going on since his death? After the 1988 Episcopal consecrations, Archbishop Lefebvre maintained firm that he would no longer be in contact with the Roman authorities to discuss any type of regularization with them until they first converted back to Catholic tradition. The Archbishop made it clear, doctrine comes first.
Yeah.
This is what he said to Fideliter magazine, issued November, December, 1988, in an interview. Quote, "I shall not accept being in the position where I was put during the dialogue. No more. I will place the discussion at the doctrinal level. Do you agree with the great encyclicals of all the popes who preceded you?" He's saying this to the popes. "Do you agree with Quanta Cura of Pius IX, Immortale Dei and Libertas of Leo XIII, Pascendi Gregis of Pius X, Quas Primus of Pius XI, Humani Genis of Pius XII? Are you, the pope, the conciliar popes, in full communion with these popes and their teachings? Do you still accept the entire anti-modernist oath? Are you in favor of the social reign of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? If you do not accept the doctrine of your predecessors, it is useless to talk.
Yeah.
As long as you do not accept the correction of the council in consideration of the doctrine of these popes, your predecessors, no dialogue is possible. It is useless." End of quote. The Archbishop said this in 1988 when John Paul II at that time was the pope.
Yeah.
Well, Eric, look what's happened since then.
Hmm.
We had Assisi's too in 2002 under the same pope, Pope John Paul II. He continued the teachings of Vatican II. Under the pontificate of Pope Benedict XVI, we have Assisi's III in 2011. Same thing. Yeah. Pope Benedict XVI continued teaching Vatican II. And don't forget, this is the same Cardinal Ratzinger that the Archbishop calls something to the effect of being dishonest. And we got to consider that, you know, this the Archbishop knew the Cardinal. Sure. Because the Cardinal was the one dealing with the Archbishop during the time of the 1988 protocol and the Episcopal consecrations. And then what do we have now? Now we have Pope Francis, the worst of them all, with his, you know, egregious words and actions against the Catholic faith on so many occasions. So, Eric, I have no doubt that if the Archbishop were alive today, he would say even more so to stay away, as far away from the as possible from the conciliar church until it comes back to Catholic tradition. He'd ask us to pray for the Pope to consecrate Russia to the Immaculate Heart of Mary in union with the bishops of the world, because only then will the Catholic Church be restored. Well, Eric, you know, I have no doubt that this grand man of the church, as I said before, Archbishop Lefebvre, will one day be canonized. And for your listeners, if they want to get more details about the life of this this great man of the church, I recommend strongly to them the biography of Marcel Lefebvre, which was written by His Excellency Bernard Tissier de Malaret. So, Eric, that comes basically to the end of what I want to say for tonight. Do you want to add anything?
Well, I just want to say, you know, thank you for your time, Tony. Great summary there. And I am totally with you right there. I mean, many of us are scratching our heads over what's going on in the leadership with the neo-SSPX in terms of trying to gain this supposed regularization. Again, from our perspective in the resistance, you know, this is ultimately going to come through a chastisement. As Tony mentioned, the consecration of Russia, it's not going to come together on the human level in the sense where there will be kind of a conglomerate of the FSSP and the SSPX and all these other, and, you know, I've actually heard this before, Tony. Someone mentioned, you know, if all these quote-unquote traditionalist groups got together, we could, you know, defeat this in 200 years. I'm like, really, 200? I mean, you honestly really think the world's going to be like this in 200 years? I mean, it's like, I mean, we're lucky if the chastisements don't come in the next year or two. So my point is I just, you know, I don't think they get the full picture. We have to continue to pray for these individuals. I know a lot of people think I'm being really hard on the Michael Matts of the world. Listen, I love Bishop Vallette. I love Michael Matt. I love everyone. But listen, you know, we got to have a little common sense here. And we stand on principle, and I think that's what's being attacked. As a matter of fact, I think recently it was Bishop Tissier who said, you know, something to the effect that, well, the resistance is just, their position is maintaining that principle. Well, yeah. Because we think it's truth. I mean, we're not going to concede truth. So for those out there who are kind of like on the fence, I'll just put it mildly, and think that the Archbishop was a little bit more pacifist and thought that we could re-enter the conciliar church and kind of rub shoulders with these moderns, listen to these strong words and bear with me here. He says, this is in 1986, in an open letter to confused Catholics. He says, "I am not of that religion. I do not accept the new religion. It is a liberal modernist religion. Priests no longer know what to do. Either they obey blindly what their superiors impose on them or lose to some degree the faith, or they resist but with the feeling of separating themselves from the Pope. Two religions confront each other." Do you hear that, everyone who is in the indult group and some of these other pseudo-traditionalist groups? "Two religions confront each other, the Novus Ordo religion of the New Age, the budding New Age, and the Catholic religion." He says, "We are in a dramatic situation. It is impossible to avoid a choice." He goes on to say, furthermore, this was in 1976, just really brief, you know, "We are not of this religion. We do not accept this new religion. We are of the religion of the all time. We are not of this quote-unquote universal religion, as I mentioned earlier in the talk. And all of these teachings are contrary to our faith. It's an immense, immense pain for us to think that we are in a difficulty with Rome because we have to maintain this faith." And lastly, he states this as probably one of his more famous one or two liners. "Rome has lost the faith, my dear friends. Rome is in apostasy. These are not words in the air. It is the truth. Rome is in apostasy. They have left the church. This is sure, sure, sure." 1987, ladies and gentlemen. So again, we have a situation where we don't, you know, Tony and I don't have the authority to say, you know, these popes are not popes, which, again, that's a whole different side topic, which I've had John Sauls on. He's actually going to come on again in April, and we're going to talk more about that, the proper way to dispose of pope teaching heresy. But the bottom line is, ladies and gentlemen, that's all we can really do in this hour is pray. You know, pray to the Blessed Virgin Mary, to continue to pray the rosary, to stay as close to the traditional sacraments as possible. Go where the faith is. And I say this always, Tony, I don't know if you've heard me say this before, when confronting a situation where I've heard from a lot of people and they say, well, the only thing I have in town, you know, 30 minutes away, 40 minutes away, is the new mass. And if I don't go, I'll be mortally sinning. No, you won't, ladies and gentlemen. We have to look at it from God's perspective. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to look at it, what pleases him. Don't look at it from the self perspective. Look at it from God's view. If the new mass is intrinsically evil, which it is, which it's illicit and schismatic, he would want you to stay home and sanctify the Sunday. So there's going to be some now, from our perspective, Tony and I perspective, that are kind of mixing that teaching up, which doesn't correspond with the Archbishop, that we would tell you that is an erroneous statement, and we would avoid that statement. So I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that, Tony, but we'll close.
Well, just one thing. You know, Eric, I think you do great work. I really enjoy your analysis of events that are to come. One thing is, you know, people see the physical chastisement as, whoa, that's the time where, you know, we should make our move to convert or to come closer to God. People have to understand that we are in a chastisement worse than a physical chastisement. Spiritual. The Second Vatican Council was a spiritual chastisement that has now caused havoc. The devil has done an amazing job with the Second Vatican Council and the reforms that follow from it. And what has happened is that God has tried to warn us, but we just wouldn't listen. So now what happens? We're at a situation today where people can't reason anymore. So what happens when people can't reason? They become like little children. Well, what do you have to do with little children? You have to slap them.
Yeah.
You have to take out the belt and strap them, right? And that's exactly what God, as a last resort, is going to be doing with these chastisements that you often speak about coming up. Unfortunately, I really don't think it's not going to stop. But humanly speaking, of course, Our Lady can intervene at any time, but she said herself at Quito and other places that it's going to get so bad that, you know, even the elect will be tempted to turn away from God, right?
Sure.
But right at that moment, when the Jews and the Freemasons and all the enemies of the Catholic Church think they've won, Our Lady's going to intercede, and by a miracle, things are going to change. Things are going to go the opposite way.
Yeah.
So we can't lose hope. You know, this week we have, at the end of this week, they're going to, the post-synodal exhortation is going to be published by the Vatican, and supposedly the Vatican is telling all bishops to make sure they have a press conference, you know, within their diocese. At least that's what I understood. Who knows what that thing is going to say, right? Either, you know, promoting the divorced and remarried to take communion, or, you know, allowing homosexuality, whatever. We're at a point now where, you know, the natural law, you can't go lower than that. Once you lose reason once you offend the natural law, there's nothing to be saved anymore. So look, we are going to have these chastisements, and people got to get prepared. But at the same time, we can't lose hope. We have to understand that it is going to happen, but it's going to be a saving grace, because many people will convert during that time. Unfortunately, it's going to take people to lose their material possessions to convert. Today we have the attitude that as long as I got food on my table, I got a roof over my head, and I got clothing on my back, everything's fine and dandy. But that's not the case.
Yeah,
that's not the case. So we are going to get these chastisements. I think you're right on a lot of things about what's coming up. And for those who are saying, you know, I'm going to convert tomorrow, don't you dare think of that. God will not be mocked. He won't be fooled. Your conversion has to happen now. Now as we speak. And once again, Eric, I thank you very much for allowing me on your show. I know you have a lot of subscribers. I know that you know, your word gets out to a lot of people, not just in tradition, but outside of tradition. And, you know, I think the Archbishop, the modern-day St. Athanasius, he needs to be known. Because, you know, he almost single-handedly, along with Bishop de Castromeyer, but more him, because Bishop de Castromeyer was more around Brazil. The Archbishop was worldwide, and you can tell from, you know, all the chapels of the society that were born from his work.
Sure.
You know, he is the St. Athanasius of this day, and you know, people, he had the right attitude, he had the right approach. And as you said, yeah, he swayed sometimes, but who wouldn't? You know, when you have the world's bishops and the Pope, the world's bishops, the world's priests against you, you start doubting yourself. But he recollected himself, he asked for guidance from our Lord and our Lady, and from 1988 onward, he was solid as a rock. And that's the Archbishop we got to have in our mind when we're approaching our daily lives, right?
Absolutely. Well, very, very well summed. I want to just make a closing comment, because I didn't want to make it seem as if I was saying just because these chastisements are coming, go lock yourself in a cave. That's not at all what I do. As Tony has mentioned, you know, he has an apostolate. There's others who are using social media to get Archbishop Lefebvre out there and just get truth out there, which is what Archbishop Lefebvre stood for. That's why, you know, we ask for donations here at TradCatKnight. It's not so Eric can go out and buy a Mercedes. It's literally so we can keep building this network, because I think everyone can see how worse it's going to get. So we're going to need to compete with these big names now in the Novus Ordo and these other, you know, the Novus Ordo website, some of the pseudo-trad websites. I don't know which way they'll lean, you know, in the days ahead. But the bottom line is we have to go out there and work. Love works. You got to go out there, do your works of charity, works of mercy, and you got to go out there, and sometimes there's going to be uncomfortable conversations between you and your neighbor if they're Novus Ordo, and you have to help them understand. I just recently was trying to help a young lady that I went to school with, and after about a week's worth of conversation, she kind of backed out, and she was pretty close to end up talking to Father Voigt directly. But you know, what more could I say to her? I just said I could pray for you. You know, I mean, I've laid out everything that, you know, the Catholic Church teaches, but there's a lot of people, you know, afraid. And so that's my prayer today, is that, you know, we can go before the Blessed Virgin Mary and ask for this denial of self and to move away from self-love, that we don't care what others have to say about us. And so without further ado, I want to again thank Tony for taking time out. Perhaps we'll have you on maybe sometime in May or June, till we come back and do, you know, another little talk. I enjoyed our talk today. And once again, get to ecclesiamilitans.com. Make sure you show him some support if you can, donate to him. Get some of his information moving out there. And let's keep fundamentally what Archbishop Lefebvre had to say alive, both in principle and practically, you know, what he applied out into our times. And so until next time, my friends, God bless, and please keep me in prayer. Ave Maria.